All right. Oh, that's too strong. Welcome, everyone. My name is Ferran Garcia Pichel. I'm the Dean of Science in the College of Liberal Arts and Sciences, and I'd like to welcome all of you who are here tonight and those of you who are watching online through a live broadcast of this second in a series of Dean of Science public lectures. We started this year in order to provide our extended ASU science community with an avenue to learn more about issues that are of relevance, of current relevance in science, that are perhaps of importance, that make a difference in our lives, or that we think they might make a difference in our lives. And this is really an event that's really for you. So the way that we will start this is we have gathered, with the help of our Department of Physics and our School of Earth and Space Exploration, a group, selected group of luminaries, no pun intended here, that have expertise in areas of physics and astrophysics that may help us understand the issue at hand today, gravity waves. Gravity waves, physicists so tell us, has been one of the biggest discoveries of the century. For some of us who are not physicists by training, that may be something we need to learn more about, and so I guess that's why we came here. And so tonight we will have a format that's very simple. Since we are professors, we'd like to lecture, and that's what we will do first. We will have a lecture, a basic lecture on the nature of the issue at hand. That's not going to last too long, because the important part is really the ability for us to interact. During this lecture, we will at least make sure that we have a common level of knowledge of the basics of this phenomenon. And then after this, we will start a session of question and answers. For both of you who are watching online, this is how you can send your answers by your questions by email, and we'll be able to get them answered for you if we have the time. Tonight, as I said, we have a group of experts that have agreed to help us with this, and I'm just going to introduce them briefly for you all. I have my cheat sheet already here ready. And so I'm going to ask all of our panelists to stand up or raise your hand when I read your name. The first one will be Dr. Maulik Parikh, who is an associate professor in physics and the Beyond Center at ASU. His work is in the areas of quantum gravity, black holes, and string theory. Then we have Dr. Paul Davies. He's a Regents professor and director of the Beyond Center for Fundamental Concepts in Science. He has authored more than 30 books on a remarkable range of topics that generally convey the excitement and mystery of physics to non-scientists. We have Professor Phil Mauskopf, who is a professor in both physics and the School of Earth and Space Exploration. His work is primarily in experimental cosmology, developing new instruments, methods to measure weak signals, particularly in the terahertz radiation. That prepares us for our physics lecture tonight. Dr. Rogier Windhorst, who is a Regents and Foundation professor in the School of Earth and Space Exploration. He works in the areas of astronomy, cosmology, galaxy formation, the cosmic dark ages, and the epoch of first light. And Professor Tanmay Vachaspati, who is a professor of physics and director of the cosmology initiative at ASU. He has worked extensively on the intersection of particle physics, gravitation, astrophysics, and cosmology. And to make all of these come together very nicely, we have a special guest tonight who is the chair of the Department of Physics, Peter Bennett, who will be moderating our discussion later on. So without any more delay, I think we'll start with our lectures, and I think we'll just go automatically through the speakers. So, Maulik.
So I'll start it. Let me. So I'm Peter Bennett, the chair of the Department of Physics. I'm the person in the front row who knows the least about this subject, so it's very nice to be surrounded by these experts. As we were setting up the event for this evening, I referred to this group on the Outlook email as the Friends of Gravity, FOG for short. And looking out, I want to welcome 200 more FOG, 200 more Friends of Gravity, all of you people out here in the audience. So thank you for coming, and thank you to Dean Garcia Pichoff for setting up the initiative to start this series in the first place. As was explained, we'll go through a sequence of presentations from these people in the front row, and we'll like to save questions for after that those presentations. We really want questions from people. It's an interactive thing tonight. We'll have microphones, I believe, on the aisles over there. We potentially, I hope, have questions coming in on email. So we have a lot of exciting, fun things to do there. We have even more FOG, Friends of Gravity, on the webcast for people who couldn't be here tonight and will tune in on the internet. So, good. My job up here is to be the essentially the timekeeper for these people, and I'll explain to the five speakers that the reference frame for time is this watch on my wrist, since you all think in relativity terms. So let me just set up the subject for 2 minutes here. As I said, I'm the person who's the least informed on the specifics of this subject, so I can say things unencumbered by the facts, as we say, and these people can straighten out after that. So let me begin with this then. Ah, I missed. The person who made all this happen in the time frame of 5 days, I think, is right over there, Ixi Papi, and for the next large gravity wave that hits the Earth, you want that person to be in charge of everything. It will go smoothly. Thank you, Ixi. So, a long time ago, in a galaxy far, far away, two black holes, each much larger, more massive than our sun, began to circle each other, going around very slowly under their gravitational pull. They gradually spiral down closer and closer under the attraction of gravity, increasing the speed of their spinning. Here is this replica of those two black holes out there. It's a sphere, but imagine one on each end of the diameter of this sphere. In the beginning, 12 billion years ago, these were going around very slowly, eons of Earth time to circle. As they come closer, they speed up slightly, like an ice skater going into a spin. It speeds up. Now the period is years on the Earth. Now it's days as they spiral in. Now it's seconds. The last six orbits of this death spiral occurred in 2/10 of a second. 30 solar masses going around each other at the speed of light almost. That event generated the gravity wave that was seen here on Earth 1 billion light years away. Amazingly weak signal delivered to a detector that the likes of which no one has ever seen before, the most sensitive detector of anything built anywhere on the planet at any time. That was waiting, watching for this gravity wave and found it. So all the excitement is rippling through the physicists for sure. Here are six of them in the front row, trembling still from the importance of this event. So with that, I'll turn it over to our first speaker, Professor Parikh, who will give us a primer on general relativity and another word I wasn't supposed to say but I already did. Maulik, it's yours.
Hello.
Yeah.
I think so. Right. So 100 years ago, Albert Einstein stepped forth in front of the Prussian Academy of Sciences in Berlin and presented his new theory of gravity. His new theory, which Einstein gave the dry name, the General Theory of Relativity, was amazing. The name doesn't do justice to how magnificent, how spectacular, and how simply awesome it is. For what Einstein had discovered was not just a new theory of gravity, but in fact, a theory of space and time. So, what I'm going to tell you about today is that story, the story of space and time, and gravity. You see, prior to Einstein's discovery, we understood gravity through the works of Isaac Newton. And what Newton had told us was, what we learned from Newton was that you could calculate the forces, the gravitational force between, say, the sun and the earth in a very precise way. But although Newton's theory told us exactly how to calculate that force, it didn't tell us what the force was. In fact, Newton couldn't explain how the sun, all the way over here, can exert a pull on the earth 93 million miles away. How does it do that? There are no ropes, there's no tethers. How does it reach across the expanse of space and draw the earth to it? So here's Einstein. So the clue to this puzzle was an experiment done by Galileo. And here's a rather romantic-looking picture of him with his wild hair. So Galileo, according to legend, climbed the Leaning Tower of Pisa in 1589. And in one hand, he had a cannonball. And in the other hand, he had a musket ball, which is like a little round bullet. And he released the two at the same time. And here's the important thing. They reached the ground at exactly the same time. All right. So the cannonball and the musket ball fall in exactly the same way. The way they fall doesn't seem to care whether it's a cannonball or a musket ball. And so I want to repeat that experiment for you in a more modern way. In fact, a hammer and a feather fall in the same way if you remove air resistance. And this is precisely that experiment on the moon.
Well, in my left hand, I have a feather. In my right hand, a hammer. And I guess one of the reasons we got here today was because of a gentleman named Galileo a long time ago who made a rather significant discovery about falling objects in gravity fields. And we thought that where would be a better place to confirm his findings than on the moon. And so we thought we'd try it here for you. The feather happens to be appropriately a falcon feather for our falcon. And I'll drop the two of them here, and hopefully they'll hit the ground at the same time. How about that?
How about that? So that was Galileo's experiment, done again by astronomer David Scott on the moon. Now, no other force behaves like this. No other force doesn't care what it is that it's acting on. And nevertheless, for 318 years, the significance of Galileo's experiment was basically unappreciated. Until one day in 1907, Albert Einstein was sitting at his desk in Switzerland, and he was daydreaming, and he had a flash of brilliant insight, which he later called the happiest thought of his life. And this thought, and what Einstein recognized was that Galileo's experiment was the key to unlocking the secret of what gravity really was. So let's try Galileo's experiment again, but this time from a bit further out. So we're going to drop two objects, here they're rocks, towards this moon over there on the right. And we'll see that not only will the two rocks hit the moon at the same time, but as they fall towards the moon, they'll converge. Okay, so what does that mean? So free-falling objects get closer together as they fall. Well, fortunately, we live in a curved space called the Earth. And if you look at these lines of longitude here, oh, I have a pointer, right? If you look at these lines of longitude, they start out going straight down, but they also converge to the, in this case, to the South Pole, or if you went up north, you converge to the North Pole. So straight lines drawn on a sphere converge, unlike, you know, if you draw straight lines on a plane, they go off forever, but on a sphere, they actually come together at the poles. So what does that mean? So Einstein looked at these two examples, and he said, well, the story is that the reason these two are converging together is because of some radial gravitational attraction, whereas the reason these two are converging is because it's on a curved space. But then Einstein thought, well, maybe this is also a curved space. Maybe what's really happening here is that this moon has curved the space around it, and that's why these objects are falling in like this, because they live in the same kind of space as this. So they're going in straight lines, but just as the straight lines on Earth converge at the poles, the straight lines in the moon's in the space of this moon converge towards the center of the moon. So this was Einstein's bold idea, and it's amazing, because in one shot, he answered Newton's questions. The reason the sun can affect planets far millions of miles away is because it has curved the entire geometry around it. It has curved the shape of space all the way out to the distant reaches of the solar system. It is as if you have a child at the center of a trampoline. The trampoline is curved not just where the child is, but also further away from it. So the sun basically curves the space, and that is why all the planets are affected, because they feel that curvature. They live in that curved space-time. This also answers Galileo's explains Galileo's experiment, because the reason everything falls in the same way is that they're all in the same space, and the orbits are determined not by the falling object, but by the space-time itself. So space-time determines how things move, and that's why everything falls in the same way, because everything is in the same space-time. Einstein then went on to make a bold prediction. He said, gravity should affect light as well. And the reason is, light also moves in space, and if space is curved, then that curvature should also affect light. This was his prediction, and it was spectacularly confirmed in an experiment in 1919, where the light of distant stars was bent. And here's a New York Times headline. It says, "Lights all askew in the heavens. Einstein's theory triumphs. Stars not where they seem to be." But nobody need worry. Yes. So all that remained to be done was to explain how exactly space-time gets curved. And for this, for many, many years, Einstein slogged away until finally, on November 25th, 1915, in front of his fellow scientists in Berlin, Einstein presented his equations, Einstein's equations, which relate the curvature of space-time to the energy of matter. So it's energy that causes space to curve. Just like the energy of children jumping on a trampoline causes the trampoline to curve. Okay, so that's the theory. But I want to say something else, a consequence of the theory. Just about a year later, Karl Schwarzschild, who was a soldier in the trenches of the First World War, while he was fighting, he managed to also solve Einstein's equation, as people do sometimes. And he found a solution to Einstein's equations, which described a particular shape of space-time. And this shape, he didn't recognize it at that point, at that time, but this shape is the shape of the space-time of a black hole. So I just want to use my remaining negative 2 minutes to tell you about black holes. So here's what a black hole looks like. And if the background is dark, here's what it looks like. All right. But seriously, what is a black hole? So a black hole, to understand what a black hole is, you need to know about escape velocity. If I throw something up, it's going to come back down. If I throw it faster, it'll go up higher before coming back down. And if I throw it really fast, it'll actually escape the pull of the Earth and disappear. That particular speed at which an object can escape the pull of the planet or is called the escape velocity. And for the Earth, it's about 11 kilometers a second. If you throw something up at 11 kilometers a second, it'll just go off into space. Now, you can imagine that making a planet that's even more concentrated with a stronger gravity, for such a planet, the escape velocity will be even higher. And you can imagine it getting even more dense, more dense, more dense, and the escape velocity will be ever higher until it reaches the speed of light, 300,000 kilometers per second. And when it does that, that's when we call it a black hole. Because why? If the escape velocity is the speed of light, that means not even light is going fast enough to escape it. And if light is not going fast enough to escape it, we can't see it. In order to see anything, light has to leave the object and come to our eyes, but light can't leave the object because its gravity is too strong. So an object like that appears black, and moreover, since nothing can travel faster than light, anything that falls in will also not be able to get out, because if light isn't fast enough, neither is anything else. And so it's like a hole, hence black hole. So black holes look black, as you can see. But in realistic black holes don't quite look like that. You can't see the black hole itself, but they basically unleash mayhem on their surroundings. And so here they are sucking up stars and destroying them and basically causing all hell to break loose. So the reason black holes are important in this story is not only because they're going to be related to gravity waves, but also because they deform space-time in the most dramatic way possible. And I would like to end by just showing you a flight simulator. And this is not an artist's depiction, but an actual supercomputer simulation of what space-time looks like in the presence of a black hole. So we're going to fall through the black hole, which we can safely do because it's just a simulation. And here goes. All right. So there's the black hole in the center. And look at this way that the space, that there's this ring around is a distortion of light from behind it. Now we're going in. This is all the stars in the back are all taking light from them is taking strange paths. That's why it looks like this. And now we've actually entered it. And we're going through the center. Then suddenly we see a flash, which is the entire history of our universe. Now we go through a wormhole. This is in the center of the black hole. It's a kind of passage through space, which is leading into the mouth of a white hole, which is an object that you can never fall into but only get out from. So here we come out from the white hole, and we're entering a new universe. And now we see the entire past of that new universe. So nobody could possibly have imagined that this is what space and time look like, and these equations are impossible to solve except with computers, but here's what it is. Now we can see, we look back in, we see our entire universe as if we're looking into a crystal ball. Thank you.
Okay, we're ready to roll. Well, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My colleague Maulik has explained to you how gravitation is not, as Newton thought, a force between objects separated in space. It is a warping of the geometry of space-time. And if gravity warps space, a gravitational wave is a ripple of space, or a ripple of space-time, technically. So it's my job to explain what exactly gravitational waves are and how they're produced and detected. So in the 7 minutes remaining, I'm happy to do a handheld. Am I going to be charged the 30 seconds it took to switch over? Let me start again. So gravitational waves are produced by any form of moving mass. So it surely should be easy to produce and detect gravitational waves. The big problem is that gravity is an incredibly weak force compared to electromagnetism. In fact, that's how weak, 1 followed by 40 zeros. And if you wanted to measure the gravitational force between everyday objects, you have to work very hard indeed. Experiment first done by Henry Cavendish in Cambridge in 1797. 2 1-kilogram masses 1 meter apart do exert a force on each other, but it's equivalent to the weight of a pollen grain held in the palm of your hand. So ordinary everyday masses are not going to produce noticeable gravitational waves. To do the job seriously, you need very large masses and very large gravitational fields. And one place where you get such a thing is the surface of a neutron star. So a neutron star is like the mass of the sun squashed down to the size of Phoenix. Some of you will notice this is not Phoenix, it's actually Santiago, where I was talking about this subject only last month, but you know, same difference. So a neutron star has immense gravitational field at its surface, not quite as good as a black hole, but there are probably more neutron stars around than there are black holes. And it occurred to people working in this subject, and I'm so old, I remember the pioneers back in the 1960s who were trying to detect gravitational waves. The one thing that occurred to them was if you had pairs of neutron stars in orbit around each other, they go into a death spiral because by emitting gravitational waves, they would be robbed of energy and their orbits would decay, and eventually they bang into each other. Now, it turns out that some neutron stars, as they spin, emit very regular radio pulses, and these are called pulsars. And by a happy coincidence, a binary pulsar system was discovered many years ago, and because the pulses are so precise from these spinning neutron stars, it's possible to monitor their orbits in space to very, very great precision. And this was done using the Arecibo radio telescope, and it became obvious after a few years that this binary pulsar system was decaying, that is, that the orbits of the neutron stars were spiraling in, and it was possible to calculate using Einstein's theory the rate at which they should be doing this. And this is the only technical slide I'm going to show. This is the theoretical prediction, that curve, and the points are the measured values. And so you can see the orbits are decaying precisely as Einstein's theory predicted. And so the upshot of this is, does this amount to the discovery of gravitational waves? Well, not quite. It's a little bit like when Maxwell predicted electromagnetic waves, and it was Hertz who produced and discovered them in the lab. It's a little bit like if you made a radio transmitter, but you didn't have a receiver, and you turned on the transmitter and your electricity bills went up. You could say, aha, electromagnetic waves exist. I'm paying more for the electricity, so the energy and the money must be going somewhere. It's obviously flowing off in the form of waves. So that was the situation that we were in a couple of decades ago. We had confidence they existed, but they hadn't been detected here on Earth. And so the great challenge has been, how can we detect these gravitational waves passing Earth coming from space? So the answer is, it's very simple, that if we look, I should say these are the black holes that are spiraling in, but if we look at what gravitational waves will do, it's very simple to imagine. Along comes a gravitational wave, as Maulik has explained. It's a distortion or warping in the geometry of space-time. So as the wave comes along, it squashes you that way and extends you this way, and then in the next cycle of wave, the wave, it does the opposite. So all you have to do to detect gravitational waves is to take any object, it could be the Earth, it could be a chunk of metal, and you look for unaccountable shaking in those bodies. And if you can detect very, very small movements, then you've detected your gravitational wave. And this was the way it was done in the early days, and this is Joe Weber, the pioneer of this subject in 1968. He built this cylinder of steel, or it could be, in one case, niobium, and was able to suspend this in a vacuum and put sensors around it that could detect very, very tiny jiggles or shudders in this bar of metal. The problem is a lot of other things produce jiggles and shudders, like students dropping pens or cows passing in nearby fields or traffic or aircraft. So it's a very, very challenging thing to screen out the noise of more prosaic sources of vibration. And it became obvious after a few years that although this was a nice first attempt, a much better way of detecting small movements was not with great chunks of metal, but with these things, that is lasers. And so along came the laser interferometer gravitational observatory. And the next speaker, Phil Mauskopf, is going to tell you all about the one that actually did the job 6 or 8 months ago, or whenever it was. So over to you, Phil.
She would not have warmed up so fast to me. I don't know. I think
so. Hello, I was born in 1968, so that's a good tie-in. So yeah, it's great to be here. I, for my students and lab workers, they've never seen me in a tie before, so that's maybe a shock, but it is me. Following on from what Paul Davies said, the first thing that I want to say, in case any of you were wondering, the Earth is not going to explode. Gravitational waves are very, very weak. And in fact, even though Paul, I have a slide, but Paul mentioned, you know, what it does to people, you're not going to feel it, probably. And so in order to detect gravitational waves, as Paul mentioned, you need to make an extremely sensitive microphone. And that's why you may have heard or seen on the announcement people talking about these things as being a new way of hearing the universe. So the next speaker, I think, is going to actually play some sounds, but I will explain why the instrument that was used to detect these is like a very sensitive microphone. So the instrument is used to detect the first gravitational waves ever detected on the Earth is called LIGO, actually advanced LIGO, because the LIGO project has been going for quite a while and they keep on making improvements. There's a picture of it there. I've got one of these things. This one. So as Paul said, I just put this in just in case anybody was worried that if there's in spiraling black holes, it may make you feel funny. It probably won't, because it'll just possibly make you jiggle a bit, but the gravitational force is the weakest force, and so it's so much weaker than the atomic forces that are holding you together that it will just, gravitational waves will just pass right through you for the most part. And they'll pass right through the Earth, losing a tiny, tiny fraction of their energy. And that's one of the reasons why gravitational waves are so interesting to astronomers and cosmologists, because gravitational waves pass through everything, which means that if we are able to detect them on the Earth by measuring a tiny, tiny signal, we're able to see through anything in the universe. And that includes seeing through into the centers of galaxies, as Rogier Windhorst is going to talk about in a little bit, but it also includes seeing all the way back to the very beginning of time itself. So that's one of the amazing things that you could possibly do once we can detect these. So how do you detect them? Well, you use a laser interferometer. And what this is, and we have a, I have a video in a minute, but you have a high-powered laser source. It shines a beam. That beam is split in half with a beam splitter. You can buy one of these yourself. Half of the light, it's 50% reflective, 50% transmitted. So half of the light goes down here. Half of the light is reflected in that direction. So now you have two arms where you have half of the light. The lights all come from the same source. So it's all going at the same, it's got the same color, and it's got the same phase, which will be important in a minute. And then each arm has these hanging mirrors. And I'll tell you why it's important that the mirrors are hanging. And also, these arms are all in vacuum, so we'll talk about that in a minute. But the basic idea is that the light travels up, hits this mirror. It actually, there's another mirror with a hole in it here. So in fact, the light bounces back and forth for a while, and then it comes back from this arm, it comes back from this arm, and then it is recombined. So 50% is transmitted, 50% is reflected. So the light overlaps itself and then is detected by that photodetector. And the way that this is able to detect gravitational waves is that the light that you measure in the photodetector depends on the interference between the light that's going down the two paths. This can be constructive interference. If the path lengths are exactly the same, the light that comes down here and comes back will be perfectly lined up with the light that came out this way and comes back, and it will interfere constructively, and you'll get bright light. But if there's a small shift in the distance along this arm compared to that one, then you'll get destructive interference and the light will disappear. Okay, so this is a picture. This is the two arms. The light's generated there. It's split. It goes down there. It goes down there and comes back. So now I need to watch, go to YouTube. This is from LIGO. And this shows what happens. So there's your gravitational wave shaking the two masses, and the light is coming out of the laser, and there's the light. And the wave, the light is a wave, electromagnetic wave. It's traveling down towards one mirror. Now it's reflecting back. It's done the same thing towards the other mirror, and then it reaches the beam splitter, and then they're combined. And as you see, the two waves are out of phase now, so the signal is canceled, and there's no light. Oh, and now one of the masses move and you get light interfering in a constructive way and then a destructive way. And now it's going to go to the next video. No, all right. We'll go back here. So this instrument, they've built two of these instruments. One is up here in Hanford, and one is down here in Livingston, in Louisiana. They're separated by about 3,000 kilometers. And the reason they built two is because, well, the first main reason is if one of them detects a signal, how are you going to know that it's really a gravitational wave? It could be that somebody was just driving their truck around one of the mirrors and there was caused a rumble and they saw a signal because of that. But obviously, that truck won't generate the same signal in this other interferometer. So if they see the same signal in both, then they're pretty sure that it's actually a gravitational wave. Also, by making more than one, you can find out where the gravitational wave is coming from, because gravitational waves travel like light at close to or at exactly the speed of light. That's one of the questions that they're going to be exploring. And so knowing this distance and knowing the difference in time between the signals, you can find out where it comes from. So you have to be able to measure this very, very small signal, and you have to be able to do it in the presence of all of these noise sources. So what are the different sources? Well, there's obviously any vibration. It's an incredibly sensitive microphone. So any vibration that you get will give you a signal. So how do you isolate yourself from the surroundings, from somebody walking or dropping a pencil? And you, what you do is you take your mirrors and you suspend them on these pendula. And a pendulum, if you shake the top of a pendulum, the bottom of it will tend not to move. But these are the most, the best and most isolated pendula ever made. What about actual gravity? What if the moon is going around the Earth or an airplane flies overhead? Well, that's gravity. That's what you're trying to detect. You can't do anything about that. You just have to know that that's not your signal. Other things are these lasers, they'll be scattered by light, so you have to run them through a vacuum tube so there's no air or anything to scatter the laser light. These are the world's largest high vacuum volume that exists. And then you're limited to quantum or thermal fluctuations, and so you can cool your suspended masses or do other things, but basically that's your fundamental limit. So advanced LIGO is so sensitive that it is able to detect these in-spiraling sources. Here's the Earth, out to a distance of, illustrated by this purple sphere. And what you can see is that these things are galaxies and clusters of galaxies. So any in-spiraling black holes or neutron stars anywhere in there will generate gravitational waves, which will travel to the Earth and be detectable by LIGO. The future, which somebody is going to talk about in a minute, I'll just mention. So these are the two observatories operating now. Virgo is going to come online soon, so there'll be three. They've just approved building this one. GEO 600 already exists, and this is another one in Japan. And beyond that, there are plans to launch one of these interferometers into space, where, of course, the vacuum is very good. You can have very long arms, and that is the ultimate place to make these measurements is in space with an interferometer. So with that, I will hand off now to Rogier, who will, I believe, talk about what the signal looks like. Oh, Maulik. Oh. You want this?
Front of the gravity center in Western Australia, where there is a laser interferometer gravitational observatory, but on a smaller scale. So they did a lot of the pioneering work for the optics there. And so my colleague and old friend David Blair has devoted his entire career to gravitational wave observations. It's always his hope that there will be one located in Australia, so that'll be out of the plane. You notice the others were all sort of more or less coplanar. Would be good to have one in the Southern Hemisphere. He's still hoping for that. The price tag is high. What is it? $300 million at least. You have to remember that Australia is a country of only about 20 million people, so that's an expensive proposition. But I should tell you, actually, as I'm talking about David Blair, when I heard the rumors about this gravitational wave discovery, it was all hush-hush for a long while. And so I contacted him and I said, is it true? Because he's plugged into this. And he said, not only am I not going to answer that, I don't want you to ever tell anybody who even asked me. Well, I think now it's official. I can tell that story. So, Maulik, over to you.
All right, so you've heard what general relativity is. It's a theory of space and time and gravity, and tells you that energy curves space-time. You've heard what gravity waves are. These are ripples in space-time caused by the energy moving around and therefore jostling space and time and sending out waves of space and time. And you've heard about LIGO, the detector. That's this very, very amazing detector that has been under construction for about 40 years and is going to detect these little fluctuations of space and time. So now, finally, I can tell you what we actually found. On September 14th, 2015, a signal arrived from space. Oops, not yet. All right, so before I Before I tell you about that signal, let me say a little bit about what a gravity wave would feel like. So, for example, if a gravity wave were to go through you right now, you would get taller and shorter and then broader and thinner. You'd sort of fluctuate a little bit like this because space itself was stretching and squeezing. So how would we perceive that? The amazing thing is we would perceive this as sound. Now you might have heard that there's no sound in space. But in fact, that's more or less accurate, but gravity waves are an exception. Is there a problem here?
Yeah. Hello? So, let's think about sound for a bit. So let's think about sound for a bit. So the way we normally perceive sound is when air molecules, when waves of air molecules, sound waves, come crashing onto your eardrum, and the pressure of these air molecules cause your eardrum to change its shape and distort in response to that, to those waves of air molecules. And our brain then interprets the changing shape of our eardrum as sound, or perhaps music. And in space, where there are no air molecules, there's no sound. There's nothing to hit on, to crash onto your eardrum. However, there's another way to deform your eardrum. If space itself is stretching, then your eardrum can change its shape, not because there are air molecules hitting it, but because space itself is causing the eardrum to distort. And so if a gravity wave hits your ear, then the change of shape that the gravity wave constitutes would be interpreted by your brain as sound. So we're listening for sounds coming from space, and so how should we interpret them when we do hear them? So allow me to be a little imaginative here. I like to think about our ancestors on the East African savanna, many thousands of years ago. And on a cloudy night with no moon, there was no light whatsoever. You know, they didn't have their iPhones to use as flashlights. And so these ancestors of ours must have had really good hearing and must have been very sensitive to the sounds around them. And you can imagine that they might have put their ear to the ground and listened for the tremors in the earth, and listened for, and then they, from experience, they would have been able to tell what those tremors were. For example, a certain kind of rumbling might be a herd of elephants somewhere, or there could be a different kind of sound, which might be a stampede of zebras somewhere, or perhaps the sound of light rain in the distance. And in order for us to understand what it is that we're gonna hear, we need to know what it is that various things sound like. And we don't have any direct experience, but we do have the equations of general relativity. And solving those equations, scientists were able to create simulations in which various events in space generated gravitational waves. So now what we're gonna do is I'm gonna play some sounds for you. And these sounds are all simulations. They're not the real thing. And then I'm going to play the real sound that we heard from space. So first we have to learn about what kinds of sounds might come from space. So the first of them is going to correspond to a giant black hole with a smaller black hole that's orbiting in a very elongated orbit. So every time it comes close, it's going to create a sound. And then we won't be able to hear it when it goes far away. So we'll hear these beats, and those are the beats as it orbits, and finally it'll get sucked up. So since this is all about sounds, we don't need any lights. Could we have the lights off, please? Okay. All right, so our first sound. if you hear that in space, that means there's a supermassive black hole swallowing up a little black hole. The sudden silence at the end was when the black hole, the larger black hole, ate the little one. And this is another example of that. This one is a more circular orbit. Let's play this one again. And, oops. And so there's a characteristic chirp at the end. So this, the smaller black hole's spinning ever faster around the bigger one. Oh, actually, we don't need the lights. I'm just gesturing for my own self. At the very end, the black hole gets eaten. And so there's this chirp at the end. It's a kind of little contented sigh of the big black hole. And this is what a pulsar sounds like. This is a spinning neutron star. That's the sound of the gravitational waves. So if you hear this kind of siren call in space, you're near a pulsar. And then this is a supernova explosion. Supernovas are stars which produce elements like carbon and oxygen, which, so everything that, all the carbon and oxygen on the Earth was once in supernovas, and once in the stars that exploded as supernovas. And they create this kind of sound. So it sounds kind of like a whale, an angry whale, maybe. And then there's a spinning black hole devouring a neutron star. So if you hear this, it's not a helicopter. The modulation of the sound is because of the spin, which changes the plane of the in which the gravitational waves are emitted. Now it's the neutron star's getting closer and closer. Chirp. And then finally, there's this sound. This is the sound of the Big Bang. Although Phil Mauskopf thinks it's not quite right. But, okay, not that you've heard it. So, right. Okay, I think we can have the lights on, please. All right, so, well, those were the practice sounds. None of those are real. They're all simulations. They're exact solutions of Einstein's theory of relativity. It took incredible computational power to generate the solutions that predicted those sounds. And now, this is a university, so now that you learned this, there's a test. And that test is the actual sound that we heard on September 14th at, I think, 9.05 a.m. or something like that. What time was it? Okay, all right. Let's do that again. What was that? There's a lot of static, so you just listen to the... There's a chirp. You hear it? Ignore the staticky sound. There's a little chirp. Does everyone hear it? That chirp was the sound of a black hole eating another black hole, and for the first time ever, I think it was an Italian postdoc who heard this sound first, the first human to hear a sound from space, and that's what it was. So here's a signal. This is the theoretical prediction of what it should look like, and that's exactly what we saw. So it looks a little messier than that because there's instrument noise. And this was in Louisiana, in the detector in Louisiana, and also in the detector in Hanford, Washington. And you can see that they both detected the same thing, so the odds are that that came from space, and it exactly matches what you'd expect from one black hole eating another black hole. So that's what it was. Now, what does it mean? So we saw that two black holes merged, and this happened 1.3 billion years ago. So, and we also learned, by analyzing the signal, that one of the two black holes weighed 36 times as much as our sun, while the other black hole weighed about 29 times as much as the sun. So how much is that altogether? 65, thank you. That was my son. He's very good at adding up masses of black holes. So that should weigh 65 times the mass of the sun. But in fact, they only formed a black hole that weighed 62 times as much as our sun. So what happened to those three solar masses equivalent? Well, by Einstein's iconic equation E equals mc squared, okay, that equation says energy equals mass times c squared. C is the speed of light. The speed of light is 300,000 kilometers per second. That's a big number. Square it, it becomes even bigger. And so when you multiply any mass, you're going to get a huge amount of energy. For example, the amount of mass that went into the Hiroshima bomb was about the size of about as much as a teaspoon.
Question is, can we see your next five slides after
this? This is the last slide. So the missing mass turned into energy and taking the form of gravitational waves. And just to give you an idea, the amount of energy released by turning those three solar masses into gravitational waves was more during that fleeting moment of time than it happened than all the energy released by all the stars in the universe at that time, in the same amount of time. And in units of billion terawatt hours, the amount was this, okay? A 2 followed by 23 zeros. And what's a billion terawatt hour? It's a big amount of energy. To give you an idea, the humanity's total energy use on all over the whole planet for the next 1,000 years would be about 0.1 billion terawatt hours. So that's a lot of energy. Okay, I think I'm being pressured into relinquishing the microphone.
Very good, thank you. So we're hoping to have time for questions. We'll get there in a moment. So saving up your questions for our panel. And our next speaker is Professor Windhorst, and he'll speak to about the cosmological implications in more broader terms once we get that wired up.
All right, for the sake of time, I'll speak at the speed of light, so we'll save some minutes there. My first slide can be skipped more or less because most previous speakers have said that. You can make that full screen for a minute. Fortunately, Paul and Maulik said most of these things. The most important conclusion for today, let's see, where's the screen here? I see it here. You want to press the right button. Let's see. Oh, here we go. So you've heard all this, number one and two. You've heard that. The most important conclusion from this discovery is black holes exist. So let's give a round of applause to the Academy Award winners of the century, black holes. Yeah, and I bet you also a Nobel Prize in the near future. So, black holes you can't see, we heard that also. Rick, we might want to turn down the light a little bit under the black holes, but you can see them gravitationally. Let's see. We've heard this in one of the talks and we've heard that. Just as a reminder, sound waves come in forms of solids. Earthquakes, for instance, or in liquids, the waves we all know, or in the forms of gases, like real sound waves you hear, like will come out of the mouth of the apartment chair when my eye go over time, which I don't intend to do. Electromagnetic waves go from very short wavelength to very long wavelengths, very roughly very hot temperatures in nature to very cold temperatures, or also very small particles, such as fundamental particles here. Very hot to very cold and very small to very large. So atomic, subatomic, atoms, molecules to people and radio towers. Where do these black holes come from? Not from ordinary stars. This is a star cluster in a large Magellanic cloud. It contains many stars, but most of these are not heavier than about 30 solar masses. Oh, the clip, I see. Yeah, here we go. Obviously, I'm not a rocket scientist. I am. And these produce, when they go boom, about 3 to 12 solar masses worth of black holes, some of these heavy stars here. These are massive stars. We call them the cosmic fraternity members. They live fast and they die young. Children don't do this at home. And it's only these stars, these heavy ones, that form the black holes. But they form tiny black holes, only, you know, 3 to 12 solar masses. And these are very inefficient black holes. Black holes come in two kinds. They come in the size of baby black holes. These ones, they're very inefficient eaters. They are very messy eaters. And then the supermassive black holes, the monster black holes we're going to talk about in just a minute. In just a minute, I need an entirely dark rig. And so these baby black holes, on the upper end of which LIGO has now seen, are sort of 30 solar masses. Apparently, they're only seen a billion or so years ago, but they were formed, as I will just argue, in the first billion years after the Big Bang. So these black holes weren't eating much for about 12 billion years, and they finally found each other and merged. So they're very slow eaters and also messy eaters. They probably don't eat everything that comes in their way. And they are leftovers from supernova explosions, as we heard. Now, all lights off, let it be dark, Rick. Can we turn all the lights off? Or do I do that here? Thank you. All right. So the very first stars were likely born in the first 500 million years after the Big Bang. They were very heavy, likely 80 to 200 solar masses. We haven't seen them yet. They're even, you know, they live faster and they die more quickly than fraternity members. In about a million years, they do their thing and they go boom. We think the James Webb Space Telescope will pick them up, the first star clusters. And they could have left 30 to 80 solar mass black holes behind, as LIGO just saw. But these are the leftovers of the very early days, the very first bout of star formation. We call it the epoch of first light. And the James Webb Space Telescope, after Hubble, will hopefully observe this in a few years. What do these supermassive black holes that we also see look like? They don't look like anything like this. Supermassive black holes have been found even today in the center of nearby galaxies. Here's a nearby galaxy like Centaurus A in the constellation of Centaurus, a giant galaxy about 100,000 light years across, enormous amount of gas and dust. This is sort of like a big spiral disk with a huge galaxy surrounding it. Very much in the middle, invisible, is a supermassive black hole. I brought a model supermassive black hole. Here it is. I bought it in Fry's this morning. I should have bought it in Einstein Bagels. It's a bagel, as you can see. And it personifies the accretion disk, which is in the very center of this galaxy. And in the very center is the supermassive black hole, which lights up the immediate surroundings. And you see nothing, because the disk of gas and dust obscures it, except when I get obnoxious and shine it in your face. It gets very annoying, right? Now, this is the accretion disk surrounding the supermassive black hole. Under the right angle, you can see this accretion. So in the next picture, I have an example of that. So here's the same galaxy tilted, and under this direction here, you can see the radio jet and the X-ray jet come out, and they come from the very inner part of this accretion disk surrounding the supermassive black hole. And you can see here, oops, what this looks like. Here's a quasar. These things are called quasars. At the very edge of the universe, this is seen at a redshift 6.4, when the universe was 7.4 times smaller than it is today. And this quasar, the galaxy isn't even visible here after you subtract a point-like signature. This contains an enormous amount of radiation coming from a very small region. Inside our solar system, I'm going to ask the young folks in the audience, there is how many stars inside Pluto's orbit? Jesse, you know this. Yeah, how many stars? One. The sun, right? Right answer. This monster has 10 to the 14 stars inside Pluto's orbit. Yeah? worth of luminosity that's surrounding the black hole, that's 10 times more solar luminosity than there is dollars in the national debt. This is an obscenely bright thing. It will give you suntan really quickly, right? We can see them literally to the edge of the universe. That's what a supermassive black hole does. It did this in the first half billion years. I have no clue how, but it's not the same kind of black hole that you just saw merge with LIGO last year. So what does this mean for us today? Well, there's this other kind of supermassive black hole. So I wanted to show a bloody T-Rex eating another T-Rex, but it was a little bit too bloody, so I took a cat. A cat is moderately appropriate. They're much more massive than the earlier kind. They eat very quickly. They do everything in the first billion years. And they also do it secretly. My cat at home eats very quickly, very secretly. It eats all the time. It's also a big cat. Yeah? Supermassive black holes do exactly the same thing. They eat all the time behind the screen of dust. Now, whether they eat neighboring black holes or just feed gas and dust to do all of the above, I don't know. If the latter is true, then we might not see a whole lot with LIGO. If the former is true, which I think is also the case, they swallow up a lot of surrounding black holes, also left over from the first stars. LIGO will see a lot of these big black holes eating their neighbors. And it will be gravitational waves with the future LIGO extinction in India and Japan and in Australia. We'll see that. So my last slide will answer the question that I think has been posed. Will this happen to us one day, our own galaxy? Absolutely. Hubble has shown that the neighboring galaxy Andromeda not only moves 100 kilometers a second towards us, but there's also no relative lateral motion. So in other words, the Andromeda galaxy 2 million light years away will collide with our own galaxy in 5 billion years. The two central black holes, this is what Andromeda looks like today. This is our own galaxy. 1 billion years from now, 2, 3, 4, 5 billion years from now, they will be two merging galaxies that look like one giant elliptical in the sky. The central black holes will eat each other, and in about 4 or 5 billion years, it will also be a dramatic event. The sun will no longer be there, so you don't have to worry about selling your real estate. So I'll leave it at this. But big black holes are yet to be observed. Small black holes, such as the baby black holes LIGO saw merging, have now indeed been seen. Thank you very much.
I'll be brief because I know you're longing to get to the questions. But I did want to take a sort of theorist view that once we have this discovery, what can we get out of it? And where's the pointer? Anyway. So basically, there are three things that sort of spring to my mind that I'm going to tell you. The first is that this can be a way to measure distances in the universe, and so this discovery kind of can help map the whole universe. And basically the idea is that if you see a signal and it has a certain time variation that you saw in Maulik's slide, he had this picture of the oscillating gravitational waves. Those oscillations, they depend on how massive those black holes are, right? And so from that, you can tell how bright the source is. But then when you look at the source, you see that it is dim. So then that tells you how far it is. And so the time variation of a signal can actually help you tell the distance of that object. And once you have accurate ways to measure distances, then you can start mapping the universe very accurately. So that is a potential use of these objects. All right. But beyond that, these objects are also a vital probe of particle physics and the very early universe, that is before galaxies were formed. And let me tell you about that. For example, you might have heard about the Higgs being discovered, and you have lots of sort of beyond standard model particle physics. Some of those models actually predict that the universe is filled with a network of strings. Right? And these strings are very heavy. They can each centimeter can be like a mountain of mass in the string. So if you have a universe filled with strings, what does it do? Well, the strings start moving. And remember, each centimeter of these strings is like a mountain. And so you have this whole network which is evolving. And occasionally you see these loops which are being chopped off. And they're moving very rapidly, like almost at the speed of light. Okay. So this is how the network evolved. But then you might have noticed that there's this faint blue spot on the left side of the screen. And that's supposed to represent the Earth. So here we are in the middle of this network of strings, and the strings are moving and producing gravitational waves. And we are hoping that at some time we'd be able to spot gravitational waves coming from some of these strings. And so LIGO is actually sensitive to these gravitational waves, and this is one way that the search for additional sort of particle physics is going on. All right. The third thing is a more theoretical problem, but it is one of the most profound problems in sort of theoretical physics today, which is that we don't really understand the nature of black holes. In 1974, Hawking showed that black holes evaporate, they emit radiation, and that has led to a sort of a crisis in theoretical physics. And there have been many sort of proposed resolutions, like black holes might be surrounded by firewalls, or the black hole is not really a black hole. There might be a fuzzball, or in some work that I did with Dejan Stojkovic and Lawrence Krauss, that there might be no such things as black holes, but there has to be some other resolution to quantum black holes. Well. So these are deep theoretical questions of the times. And maybe this event where you have black holes which are colliding can actually help resolve some of these questions. For example, if you have black hole 1 and black hole 2 collide, they just give you, they collide to form a bigger black hole, and it gives gravitational radiation. But if you have something else, like a fuzzball or a firewall or a black star of some kind, then it will emit gravitational radiation, and then also it will emit some kind of light. Okay. So now the funny thing is that that Fermi, which is a satellite experiment to detect gamma rays, actually saw a burst of gamma rays about half a second after the gravitational wave event. So the question is, was this gamma ray burst event associated with the LIGO event? And that is something that is not quite known yet. Maybe it's just by chance that there was a flash of gravitational waves and then followed by some other source which emitted gamma rays. So, however, that seems unlikely. Now, it could be, as Rogier was pointing out, that black holes are in messy environments. And maybe there's some astrophysical stuff going on, or it could be something much deeper. Anyway, I just want to close with saying that the fun has just begun.
So we can bring up the house lights, and let's begin our questions. Finally, we do have the room for about a half an hour before Roger's class takes over. Please, here. Oh, I'm sorry. We're going to put the five panelists up here. Your chairs are over there. How many physicists does it take to bring a chair to the center? Please, your question was.
Okay. So
there's a microphone.
Going back to the first lecture, when we went into the center of the black hole, why did we see the burst of light that was the entire history of the universe?
So this is a Jeopardy game, whoever hits the buzzer first. But I think that was your simulation, if I remember.
Hello. So the question was, why did we see flashes of light
Projector off, blank.
Yes.
In 30 seconds.
That's not an easy question to answer.
In 20
I think
seconds.
Space-time, space. Okay, so black holes deform space and time, and to really see, I don't have a sort of intuitive answer for that, but all the light in the universe that went in that, that entered the black hole, well, if
Ten
you look,
seconds.
Come on, Peter. Time. If you look outside, you're going to see all the.
Gravity makes time slow down. When you're in the middle of a black hole, time stops. And that means that all of the history of the universe to you is visible all at the same time.
That's my story. Okay. I'm sticking with that one. Thanks.
That's a simplified version. Maybe I should have handled it.
Right here?
I think it was a bit.
Please.
Okay. So if you experience a gravity wave, does it make time slow?
When it comes to a gravity wave passing through you, does it make time speed up and slow down relatively? And would that influence the measurements of LIGO in any way?
Gravitation is a distortion in the geometry of space-time. So it warps space and it warps time, and all that is factored into what LIGO is doing.
Oh, great.
It's in the equations. It was in the first presentation on general relativity, I believe, right? And an excellent question. Here, please.
So I saw a graphic that showed the approximate location of the source, but it was very vague. It's a very large area. What will it take to pin down that location? Is it just more detectors?
So I'll answer it this way. There were these two L's. L-shaped detectors, and you know, it's a three-dimensional problem. So there's not quite enough information to determine the location precisely, but there was, you know, a banana-shaped location error. If you had a third or a fourth L, you could narrow that down to a considerably smaller circle. If you then also get a gamma ray burst or an X-ray burst at the same time, which the Fermi satellite saw, then you got a smoking gun, and the Fermi satellite has a much smaller error bar. You can actually say which galaxy this might have done.
They do know the general direction from which the wave came because it was 6 milliseconds from Washington to Louisiana. That's half of the universe, apparently,
but
on that direction.
There are other experiments, but they were not functioning at that time. So.
Towards the back, any?
What's the period of that gravitational wave?
Yeah, well, we heard it. It was, it sped up, and then it stop when it swallowed the two black holes coalesced. It was about a few hundred hertz.
I think it goes from 40 to 260 hertz, so it's from the leftmost side of the piano to middle C.
And that was, remember the ball we had here? It was the collapsing ball, and the last six revolutions of these two masses happened in 2/10 of a second, and exactly the period went up to 200 hertz or so, right in the audible, middle of the piano scale.
It's exactly middle C, 260 hertz.
Sounds like this.
How often do you expect to hear the chirp?
Great.
So
when will we see the next one?
Right. So with one, you don't know. The estimates before Advanced LIGO ranged, but had sort of the middle was about one per month. The rumors are that they have another four or five.
That's what I heard too. And if you want to see the merging of the very early black holes, you need a bigger LIGO, which is now being built all over the Earth. And the star formation rate back then in the universe was so much higher than it is today, you could conceivably get a lot more than that, perhaps once a day or even more. So it could be, you know, pretty loud, regular rock music out there from the epoch of first light.
My clipboard.
Fun in the front also here.
There's one in the dark back there.
Huh. Okay, for a particular celestial event, is there only one chance to get the waves heard? Or do we get more chances like it comes back someday?
Oh, for every event.
Well, that particular wave travels at the speed of light. It goes right through the Earth, and it's gone off out the other side, and it won't come back, if that was what your question was.
Yes, yeah, so yep. You can only hear it once.
Yeah, yeah. You don't... No use even chasing after it. You won't catch it.
Other ones next month.
Well, strictly speaking, I mean, if the wave is lensed, then you might get a second shot at it.
Ah.
Yeah.
They were actually not going to turn the detector on for another couple of weeks, and they would have missed it.
Exactly.
How long are the lasers running for, like, at any given time for testing?
So they run before in between. So they upgrade them and then they do a run. The run before Advanced LIGO I think was 3 years, and then this run is supposed to be another similar time.
9 years on the first one.
Yeah.
With no discernible signal. Here's a question up front.
No, they had an upgrade.
So you heard the signal on this planet, but if you were a planet much closer, with what kind of a day would that have been like for that person on that day and that planet?
Yeah, I was just at a meeting last week where somebody was asking, or we were talking about that. What would it feel like if this happened in our galaxy nearby? And I think we decided it wouldn't have been that bad, but...
Well, Joe Weber would have detected it.
Yeah. So I forgot what kind of note of music this was, C or an A, somebody said, but the object is 1.3 million billion light years away from us, very roughly a redshift of 0.1, 10% of the look-back time all the way to the beginning. So if you wish, the note would have been deredshifted or that much higher in frequency by about 10%, so that would put an A to, I forgot.
So where are
music, but what would that be? It's a little higher.
We're talking about,
you wouldn't
know this
feel
person,
it.
He's a hospice minister, he's thinking about
you
what
wouldn't feel
happens
it.
At the end. Could there be tidal waves, buildings falling? Is this at all physically possible?
Could it destroy
the gravity wave? No. I think we calculated that even if it were the, you know, at the position of the sun, it's still, you might just barely be able to feel it.
Let's turn the problem around. The Milky Way probably has had quite a few of these black hole mergers already in the past, and we're still here today. So it can't be that bad. Now, if it happened right next door, then I would need to think about that. Maybe.
the answer was, don't worry about it. Unlike the 7-year-old Woody Allen, who's depressed because the universe is expanding. We should not worry about it on that level, apparently.
But I'd like to qualify that just a bit. If the Fermi detection is correct, then I think you're also looking at gamma ray bursts that follow black hole mergers, and then there could be something dramatic.
Or if it's a cosmic string and that goes through you, you feel a jolt.
Yeah.
This is great. We're loving it. Everybody is in their stride now. I want to inject, I do have a few questions from email. I want to be sure to get a few of these done. So let me do one right now. This comes from Xavier Coy. He's a junior at La Jolla Community High School here in Phoenix in the classroom of Zachary Kovach, physics teacher at that high school. And Xavier is asking, are the shapes of gravitational waves defined by the shape of the object? A circular object has circular waves and so on. What about the shape of the gravity wave? For Xavier, who wants to do that?
Yeah, I'm not sure about the circular bit. Certainly the shape of the wave is determined by the motion of the source. Now, obviously, if the source itself is distorted, and I think Maulik played some of the sound from what would be an elongated source, that's going to affect the waveform. But basically, in this particular case, we've been looking at the waveform is determined by the motion of the two black holes as they orbit around each other. It'll be slightly changed because of the tidal pull. The black holes get distorted in shape by each other, and so that will affect to a certain extent, but it's primarily the motion of the objects, not the shape of the objects. I should say that would not be the case if you were looking at a much weaker source, which is from a spinning neutron star, which might be
not axisymmetric. It might be a bit lumpy and bumpy, and then its shape would definitely be reflected in the shape of the waves, but that's a much weaker source.
Very good. So, Xavier, I hope you heard that on the internet, if he's streaming with us here. Another live, you did one before. Do we have right up here a microphone? Yes.
Yeah, looking forward 1, 5, maybe 10 billion years or so, how do these new tools that we're bringing online here shortly expect to be used to improve our evolutionary model of the universe?
Well, for the future.
So if you, I mean, one question that that in cosmology that is of a lot of interest is how fast the universe is expanding. And for that, you basically map the galaxies and you look at their recessional velocities. And from that, you find that that there's a need for dark energy, for example. So you need better tools to map the universe. And maybe these can provide you a better tool.
So another thing is that, you know, LIGO currently has two of these L-shaped arms, and they're building other ones in other countries, India, Japan, Australia, Europe, I think, underneath the Mediterranean. So the more you have, the better your resolution gets. You can eventually also find other kinds of objects. There's a concept for space called LISA, the laser interferometer. Gosh, I'm blanking out now. Space interferometry or so. That will do this for much larger distances between the L-shaped arms. And that should get you different frequency of the black hole merger gravitational waves, also allow you to see the more massive ones. That should be very interesting to answer the question of the first stars.
That experiment features space-based mirrors that make this interferometer on the scale of the Earth's orbit. How they will send a laser beam out and get it back and do interference to a tiny, tiny fraction is a major project coming up. Up here?
So by how much did the mirrors shift?
Ha! That's Bill.
Yeah.
All right.
Okay. approximately one atometer or slightly smaller.
Yeah, we need to define that. Less than the nucleus of an atom in the way, yeah. In the 4 kilometers or whatever it is. But relatively speaking, it's like the width of a human hair in the distance of the nearest star. And that was always the target sensitivity way back when I wrote my book, The Search of Gravity Waves in 1980, that those numbers have been identified. It's a fantastic challenge. It's amazing that you can do measurements to that level of sensitivity.
I hope you heard that. Paul Davies wrote the book in 1980 predicting
I've been waiting a long time for this.
Congratulations.
Will the ability to detect gravity waves someday be able to give us the ability to look into the center of a black hole, thus actually see the interior of what's going on?
No, because by definition, a black hole is bounded by an event horizon. That is, it's whatever happens inside the surface of the black hole, the event horizon can never be seen from the outside. And the reason it's black, as Maulik explained, is because nothing can get out, even light. So you can't ever see what's going on inside the black hole, but very close to it.
Clearly, gravity is getting beyond the event horizon.
That's correct.
So how
but it can't convey any information. Gravity has no information. So a black hole has a mass, electric charge and an angular momentum, and all of those things are felt on the outside, but they don't convey any information. That is, you can't send a signal. If you were inside the black hole, you couldn't use those parameters to signal anybody on the outside.
Yeah, so nothing gets out of the black hole, not even gravity waves. And that's what, so all the gravitational radiation that's emitted is emitted before the object falls into the black hole. That's why there was a chirp at the end, and after the chirp, there's nothing.
So it's all the distortion of the space-time in the vicinity of the black hole, not inside it.
But there is a question, as I tried to explain very quickly, that the quantum nature of the black hole is not fully understood. And maybe black hole collisions can maybe help understand the nature of the black hole itself.
You could
jump into one, and then you'd find out what happens inside. But you can't tell anybody else about it.
What exactly is a warp in time, and how would that be reflected in the universe?
Do you want me to have a go at that? It's very simple, and it's astonishing. You can measure time warps almost without leaving the room. There was a famous experiment done in 1959 at Harvard University. It basically means that the rate of a clock on down on the ground and the rate of a clock up a tower are slightly different, measurably different. So clocks run slightly faster up on the roof than they do in the basement, and you can easily measure that today with modern atomic clocks. So this is well within the capability of our instrumentation. It's even more if you go into space. So if you put a clock on a rocket and send it into space and compare the ticks of the clock up there with the ticks of the clock down here, is measurably different. You can do it in aircraft as well. So all of these things are now well within the capability of our technology. And in fact, the GPS system that you use to navigate around Phoenix, if you don't know where you're going, that depends on factoring in the tiny time warps, which are implicit in the general theory of relativity. If that wasn't in the algorithm that computes where you are, you would get lost within, a few hours anyway.
So let me inject another question from a high school student. Now, panel, you need to listen carefully to this. This comes from Max Pizzelli in the classroom of Alan Friesen, physics teacher at Arete Prep Academy. Okay, here's from Max. Bicep 2 in early 2014 reported that they detected evidence for primordial gravitational waves from the Big Bang by looking at the polarization of light from the CMB. Later, it turned out they had probably detected galactic dust. Is advanced LIGO sensitive enough to directly detect those ancient gravitational waves? Thank you for this opportunity. Max, I have a question for you. When are you coming to ASU?
Yeah, we want
and
you as our
student. Compliments to Alan Friesen and his theoretical physics club at Arete Prep Academy. So, the answer?
No.
He doesn't know, in other
words. No, I do know. No, unfortunately, the answer is no. The LISA interferometer will be potentially close to being able to detect those white noise, the sounds, white noise that Maulik played, but LIGO, advanced LIGO, and for probably several upgrades to come, is pretty far from being able to do that.
Max, is that good enough? Thank you.
We can have you do a dissertation topic on this if you come to ASU.
Seriously? Yes. No, seriously.
Yeah,
have high school students with you now.
Oh, absolutely. We already have some high school students.
You heard it?
Is there any correlation between gravitational waves if they are more advanced and any connection?
Gravity waves connected to dark matter and dark energy.
No.
You stumped them.
Well, I mean, yes, in that dark matter and dark energy. Well, dark energy affects the expansion of the universe, which, as Tanmay has said, you could be able to measure more precisely by measuring different events and knowing how far away they are. And yes, in terms of dark matter, in that dark matter interacts gravitationally, and so dark matter is a component of the matter in a black hole, potentially, but not in any sort of necessarily special way that would allow you to distinguish between a dark matter black hole, say, and a non-dark matter black hole.
So dark matter is, as well as dark energy, is very diffuse in space. Dark matter tends to clump more. Dark energy is everywhere. For gravity to produce these waves, something has to be very clumpy, like a black hole is excellent.
Right. Yeah, I was going to say that.
Yeah.
Over here. There's
Once one of those signals is detected, how long does it take for it to be analyzed? Especially if we think that a gamma ray burst comes right after, how long would it take to decide, let's point telescopes there?
Fabulous question. How long did it take this time?
Yeah,
So not very long. There, in fact, the LIGO consortium has said that they are going to be issuing announcements, public announcements, after they have analyzed and understood at least some number of first detections, much like the gamma ray observatories. Whenever they see a gamma ray burst, they make a public announcement within as soon as they possibly can, within minutes or some amount of time like that. So the gravitational wave observatories will be operating in that way so that anybody in the astronomical community can go and look in the direction that they say is the most likely place where the gravitational wave has come from.
I'm going to answer that one in a different way because I read about it this afternoon. I thought you were asking how long from the observation until the announcement. Is that what you asked? That's what I'm going to ask. How long was that? They saw it at 4 a.m. Marco Draco, the postdoc, saw it, fell off his chair. Suddenly, 1,000 people in the collaboration knew about it on the internet. It took 5 months after that before the paper, the announcement was made public. And that's the time it took that team of 1,000 people to make absolute double, triple, quadruple sure it was a real signal before they release it to the public. Absolutely amazing story. But you didn't ask that question, so.
No, she wanted to know how quickly one could follow up. And for some of these satellites, is within seconds. But the satellite has to have sort of like an omnidirectional sensitivity to see this, because you can't slew a satellite that quickly to a location, even if you had one, except for some specially designed missions.
Here's one right up here.
So it's already been said tonight that these gravitational waves propagate at the speed of light and that we can consider them like gravitational radiation. So essentially I'm wondering how far that analogy to electromagnetic radiation goes. Like, do gravitational waves interfere constructively and destructively? Do they have polarizations?
Yes, they're actually very much like electromagnetism. The one difference is that they have two polarizations. Instead of an electric field, for example, just oscillates up and down, but a gravitational field, as we saw, simultaneously does this. There's also polarization in the other direction. So there are actually two polarizations, unlike the polarization looks different from electromagnetism, but otherwise it can add constructively and so on.
How long until your class comes in, Professor Windhorst? I'll go see how many are out there waiting.
Why aren't they here?
Yeah.
They didn't pay, right? So, right here?
Up here, Peter.
There's a microphone up here already. Yeah.
You said nothing can escape from the black hole. Then what is the proof of a wormhole and entry to the another universe? Like, what is the theory behind that?
So that's very speculative. So nothing can escape from black hole in the sense that if you enter it, you can't go out the way you came in. But there could potentially be a passage out somewhere else. So there's a one-way entrance, you can't go back the way you came in. But mathematically, it is theoretically possible for there to be a sort of a tunnel, a wormhole into some other universe, but it's actually considered highly unlikely because this tunnel is so unstable that the slightest perturbation will cause it to collapse. So most probably, if you fall into a black hole, that's it.
It's a bad day, as we were saying. Let's take two more questions, and then we should let the class come in just after us.
This one is probably for Paul. As you said, that they've been searching for these waves for many years. I actually heard a Weber talk when I was in a freshman physics, which shows you how old it is. So in retrospect, and this is only advanced LIGO, so why did the first LIGO and all the other in retrospect, why did they not detect a signal? Is it just the sensitivity was so?
Yeah, you know, I asked myself that question. I watched the press conference and this textbook waveform, and I thought, well, I don't know. It's currently, I think it's about only three times more sensitive than the original LIGO. It's going to be tuned up and be better. And so I thought to myself, and I still think,
you know, now we know that this can be done for real, a bit like when people first found extrasolar planets, they knew how to do it, then they've got much better at it. Is it possible that we might go back and look at the data from LIGO and, you know, look a little bit more carefully and see that it was detecting events with a lot more noise? Is it possible to dig signals out of the noise? I don't know. I've wondered that.
No? Well, these were very massive black holes, right? 30 solar masses. I mean, for lower mass, you'd see less of a signal, less amplitude. And this was above the noise sufficiently, but there will be ones that will be lost in the noise.
Yeah, well, at my university, before I moved here, there was a big group that was involved in analysis of data from LIGO. And I can tell you, Paul, if there was anything there, I think they would have found it. And I think that it is just really the critical increase in the sensitivity. And just, I don't know if I give this impression, but the increasing the sensitivity by a factor of three increases the number of events that you could possibly detect by a factor of three cubed, because it increases the volume of your reach. And so an increase in raw sensitivity by that much is actually much bigger of an increase in terms of numbers.
Part of the sensitivity issue is to close the background, define the background, and that was another fascinating component of this recent discovery, is there is a team implanted there whose job it was to secretly inject signals that are fake signals and see if the team will find that out. And how tense a moment for a few days to strangle these people to make sure they did not put the fake signal in. It took 5 months to complete that process.
An equally important development was that of computational physics, where now they can analyze the equations very accurately and for a long period of time and actually develop templates like the signals you saw. The numerical thing overlapped the experimental completely. And that was a huge advance. And now when they see a signal, they compare it to templates and to try and fit the templates. But for that, you needed this development in sort of computational techniques and very smart algorithms.
And smart professors also. Here's one more question here.
So you said that the gravitational waves are actually produced by the motion of matter. So if we were here on Earth to cool down an environment as close as we could to absolute zero, would we be able to actually experience lower gravitational fields inside that vacuum? Or not, because of Earth's gravitation affecting the vacuum itself, right? Okay. So Then just in an absolute zero environment, would there be no gravitation because of no motion?
There would be no gravitational waves generated. But the waves are forces of gravity that are oscillating in time, but the force that we feel all the time, which is a constant force, is present just if there is mass at all, and it doesn't matter what the temperature of that mass is. So mass that is at rest produces gravitational forces that are static or not changing. Masses that are moving produce gravitational waves.
All right, so I think you will agree with me that this was a wonderful evening. We learned a few things about gravitational waves, about the warp of time, and how professors can make time warp when they talk and present their things. I'd like to ask the audience here and those at home watching us to give a round of applause to our invited people. Thank you. Also to our moderator. And I would like to invite everybody we're preparing another lecture. I think our next one will be on genome editing as the new hot topic. And if you want to be joining the listserv for these Dean of Science lectures, you can send an email to doslecture@asu.edu and you will be at it. So with that, thank you everyone again for your help, and good night.